We're here with Shane T just to have a chat about the Mazworx S15 drag car that Shane's been involved with. Just recently, that car has run as fast as a 650 at 221 mile an hour for a four-cylinder SR20 engine. That makes it number two in the world for fastest ET. And with so few runs on the board since a full rebuild, it's fair to say that it's still got a lot of potential to take that record. So Shane, prior to you getting involved with the car had run a 670, going from a 670 to a 650, also it was 207 mile an hour to jump to 221. That's a big difference. Can you start by telling us what changed in the car to make that difference?
Well, I guess I should start like every other tuner and say it was all due to me. But no, the reality of it is that they wanted me to come in and try and help them with their existing hardware that they had in the car. And I looked at what they had and I said, I think you'll be better to just do what I know is already working in some of the other projects I'm working on. So basically, this is a four-cylinder version of the six-cylinder 2J stuff that I play around with. We put an intercooler back on the car. We put my entire M150 powertrain management system in the car, which is the ECU, the power distribution module, the dash, all that stuff. Changed lots of things around with how the car functions, clutch-wise and all those. Like, everything on the car is basically different. We've been doing this for more than a year, trying to get all this stuff lined up. We took the engine to the dyno and ran it on the dyno. We had a great time with it. It made 1,800 horsepower. And so then we were really excited to put it in the car. Muhammad Ali, the owner of the car, you know, his big concern when he brought me on board was, man, I would like to have better performance than we have. I would like to be consistent. And man, I want to win. So now, after last weekend, we've managed to accomplish all of those things. But it's been over a year's worth of work from all of us collaborating and working back and forth and getting things on the car that we need. So it looks like it's an immediate success. And it is. We've been very successful with it quickly, but it's been a lot of behind the scenes work to get it to that place.
I think that's probably one aspect that a lot of the public looking in don't get to see. They see a car that goes out after a fresh build, runs 12 passes and gets that close to a world record. But as you say, there's a lot of behind the scenes work that goes in. And of course, there's also the knowledge of the people involved who have already run those sorts of numbers to know what to put on the car and make it work. I just want to step back a little bit. You just mentioned that you refitted an intercooler to the car. Now, it's quite common with methanol boosted engines to run no intercooler. So what are your thoughts on that? Where are the pros and cons of the intercooler versus no intercooler debate?
So it comes down to the pressure ratio that you're trying to run. Because at some point, you're going to run the turbo to the end of its limit. And at that point, it's really inefficient. It makes a lot of heat for the amount of boost pressure that it makes. And you simply can't get the heat back out of the air charge with methanol without an intercooler on it when you run it that hard at the end of the turbo.
So is this the difference between the import engines? Obviously, you've got very small displacements, so you're running 70, 80, even 100 plus PSI, sure, compared to the Pro Mod engines where we don't typically see intercoolers, but their boost pressures are much lower?
Yeah, and if you look at where you are mass airflow-wise on the compressor map with a small engine, you're running it way up the left side of the map, right, and up off the top, where the larger Pro Mod engine moves enough extra air that it's in a more efficient spot on the map. And it doesn't take much of a change in efficiency when you're so horribly far off the map to begin with. So from the experience of, you know, working on the cars in Bahrain and all the other stuff that I work on, I knew we needed to go to an intercooler. And, you know, we did, and we knew we were going to run it right out of turbo because that's the best way. Small engine, big turbo is always a win. And, yeah, I mean, it just works. And it works. It's exactly what that 2J is with a bigger turbo on it. It's basically two-thirds of a 2J, and it makes two-thirds of the horsepower of a 2J.
Now, when you're running a small capacity engine like that with a large turbo, and you've already mentioned you're sort of running right out to the left-hand side of that compressor map, if everything's working well, that's all going to work out, but if the car goes into tire shake or the driver has to short shift or something like that, you can get into problems with running past that surge line on the compressor map. So is there anything you're doing to deal with that?
Yeah, of course. Like, so for example, we can't get the boost we want on the starting line if we don't open the intake wastegate and allow more air to flow through the engine, through the turbo, but not through the engine, because we can't stuff it through the engine. That's why it wants to surge. So basically what we do is create a leak that puts the airflow rate more to the right side of the map, and that stops the turbo from surging. So on the starting line, we have a shaft speed of the turbo that's enough to, say, make 35 or 40 pounds, but the actual inlet manifold pressure is only 30 because we're bleeding some air off through that wastegate to keep it from surging. And as soon as a clutch comes out, the gate slams shut, the boost jumps up, and the RPM of the turbo just rises up to the point where we wherever we want it as far as how much boost we're going to run.
Now, that launch control, just because you've mentioned that, or the staging strategy, that's so critical, particularly with a car that runs a slipper or slider type clutch, to get consistent engine torque at the point that the driver actually drops the clutch and leaves the line. So you've just talked about that wastegate to bleed off some of that excess air. What else are you using in that M150 ECU package to actually build the boost, and how are you controlling the boost on the start line?
The easiest way that I've found to make these things very consistent on the starting line, number one is the intake gate, because it's also modulating that gate, right, based on manifold pressure. So if it goes up and down, it moves the inlet gate. The exhaust gate is closed, and it's standard anti-lag strategy with ignition cut and timing retard to give enough energy to the turbine to get the turbo revved up enough to make the boost you want. And then as far as down the racetrack goes, the wastegate on the exhaust side is used as it typically would be, but with a little engine, you're all in pretty quick. So it's almost how fast can I get it to make all the way everything it can make? And the turbo on the dyno would make about 62 pounds of boost, but it didn't have any head pressure on the front of it like it has when it's going 200 miles an hour at the other end of the racetracks.
When you're talking about head pressure there, you're talking about essentially a ram effect into the compressor?
Yes, yeah. Ram air, when you go 200 miles an hour, you can pick up about 1.5 pounds of pressure. And so that extra pressure on the front of the turbo gets multiplied by the pressure ratio that the turbo's running at. In this case, we're running almost 6 to 1. So 1.5, 6, we get about another 9 or 10 pounds more boost, but only at the other end of the racetrack. So it's a matter of chasing the exhaust pressure as you go down the racetrack, and you're just slowly adding and adding and adding to hold it at 1 to 1 all the way down the racetrack. It ends up at 70. But if you start with that same amount of pressure on the wastegate earlier in the run, you get the back pressure over the top of the boost. So, yeah, it's just a game. And it's, you know, with a little engine, you're just picking, right? And that race last weekend was probably the best I've ever done at controlling myself from just wanting to fix everything all in one run, because that usually doesn't work. You usually spend 10 runs backing yourself up, you know. So once we kind of ran the number we ran last week, it was like, we can win with this. So now I'm just going to try to run this same number every time we go to the starting line. And at the end of the weekend, when you lay all the time slips up next to each other, we ran between 650 with a 9 and 655 with a 9 on 5 consecutive runs.
That's pretty impressive consistency. When it comes to actually making tuning changes to the car at the track, and I'm not necessarily talking about fuel and ignition, what I'm talking about here is tuning the car to maximize the amount of grip available to the track. So what are you looking at, and what changes are you making?
Just about anything that you tune electronic fuel injection, you're not actually tuning any parts of the engine on the racetrack. It's all power management, right? So you're watching typically the driveshaft speed or the speed of the car, the acceleration rate of the car, and some suspension sensors to try to understand what the tire's doing. The problem with a slick is that it's a spring that you can't control, right? So when a drag slip slick leaves the starting line, it winds up almost from a side profile like a clock spring would, right? And you've got to hold that spring wound as tight as you can get it without over torquing the tire and spinning it against it, because as soon as you do that, you lose grip, and then you're going to have tire shake. So it's a fine balance, but using the control strategies in the ECU makes it a lot easier to manage. I mean, effectively, it's got closed-loop traction control running it down the racetrack, just like you would do if you were at Bonneville or if you were at Standing Mile or anywhere else. So it certainly makes it easier, and it makes it more predictable, and it makes it way more fun, because really, once you've got it on that traction control curve, you can add all the horsepower you want, and the ECU will just work harder to hold it on that curve. And if you want to make the car faster, you just move the curve up. Now the car goes faster.
So when you're talking about that curve there, you're not looking at front to rear wheel speed for slip. You're looking at drive shaft speed and profiling that against your theoretical ideal perfect run?
You've got two ways to do it. So obviously with a drag car, most of them have the front wheel off the ground, so you can't use traditional front wheel speed versus rear. So two ways to do it. The most common way is use a timer. That's crap, because it's got nothing to do with the actual position on the racetrack or the speed of the car, and it doesn't feed into itself. So in other words, if you put a timer up of drive shaft speed over time, and you have a graph that's going to let the engine rise at this certain rate, and then you start in water, it's not going anywhere, right? So the other way to do it is use GPS. So on the cars in the Middle East, I have GPS on a few of them, and we actually still have basically speed versus rear wheel speed to do the control like a traditional traction control would work. In this case, it's just timer, drive shaft over time, and it tries to control to that rate. So you still have to make that match the racetrack. If you go to a track that's crap or start in the water box, that rate's not going to work anymore.
You just talked about GPS there. A lot of the GPS units that we're conventionally using only update at about 10 hertz or thereabouts, and my own sort of research has shown that's nowhere near fast enough for traction control. So what are you actually using?
So a 10 hertz GPS is plenty fast enough as long as you are less than 1G of acceleration. Like at Bonneville, where we run about a half or 6/10 of a G, GPS at 10 hertz is no problem. But absolutely, it doesn't work in a drag race because you outrun the GPS. But I'm using a 50 hertz GPS, so that fixes that problem.
All right, in terms of the actual strategy, once you know that you're into wheel spin, what are you using in the ECU? Are you using ignition cut, retard, all of the above, boost control?
Right, so the most definitive thing would be cut. It's because you know you're going to get what you asked for. And if you spend the time on the dyno beforehand to program a timing retard curve so you know how much power it's taking away with a given amount of timing, and that actually ends up having to be a three-dimensional map because, like at peak torque, it's different than it is at either end of the curve. So the bottom line is use an ignition retard mostly on a car with a slick, because you're dealing with that spring. When you cut a cylinder, that interruption in the torque gets an oscillation going in the driveline, and it sometimes makes it want to shake the tire.
In terms of using the retard on a turbocharged car, though, there are some downsides with that as well. You're adding exhaust gas temperature when you retard the timing, and in turn, that actually adds energy to the turbocharger. So is controlling all of that a problem? Sort of, do you go around in circles with that sort of situation?
So you absolutely go around in circles if you don't do enough ignition retard. So at some point, you can take enough efficiency away from the engine and put it in the turbo that even if it makes 10 pounds more boost, it still makes less horsepower at the crankshaft. So it's really just a matter of having it have a huge control range to be able to make up whatever it needs to keep that tire doing what it's doing, or what you want it to, let's put it that way.
All right, look, thanks for giving us some insight into that, Shane. Certainly, given that it's such a new combination with so few runs on the board, yet so close to that world record already, coming into winter here in the United States, so really look forward to seeing what that car does next year. And is it fair to say that world record's in danger?
There's no doubt we're going after it. Like, if you look at the speed that the car runs versus the ET, you can see that we're out of balance. The car's way faster, which means it makes a lot of horsepower, but it means I'm not very good at figuring out how to get that on the racetrack. But I'll work on it, and I just haven't had time to work on it more than what we did last week. So we will get there. I'd be shocked if we didn't own that record by the end of next year.
I will look forward to seeing it happen. Thanks, Shane.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson. You'll learn about performance engine building and EFI tuning, and you'll also have the chance to ask questions, which I'll be answering live. Remember, it's 100% free, so follow the link to claim your spot.